It's one thing to know how to run a restaurant. It's another thing to get into food processing.
You know, it came out of a question. Why and where did cider go, right? Why are people not drinking cider?
In the early 90s, I came across a homemade cracker recipe.
Meaningful work in a place that we love with people that we love.
It's not quite Thunderdome, but it's not Thunderdome.
You know, some food is just about perfect right out of the ground. Or off the branch. It's good. But as much as we all love fresh local produce in its purest state, the fact of the matter is that lots of food has to get processed in some way, shape, or form before finding its way into your kitchen. Processed foods, I know. You're already thinking about fruit snacks, right? Cheese puffs.
Maybe factory generated.
High salt content, high sugar content.
Processed foods, I think of like Cheetos.
Something you could buy out of the freezer at a gas station.
White sugar, white flour, and processed, like hydrogenated fats,
yeah.
Oils.
Pretty easy for me to get hit with a bad migraine when I eat a lot of that stuff.
But not all processed food is created equal.
I feel the same way.
Processed food doesn't have to be a bad food.
But like when I buy bread from Bread and Butter Farm, I guess it's processed, but it's like the most wholesome bread you could buy.
Would you consider an artisanal organic veggie burger made with locally farmed beans as a processed food? Because you should. A lot of what we call value-added products, we can process right here in Vermont, and they create a crucial link between the folks who grow our local food and the rest of us who want to eat it. So, today, we're going to look at why the concept of processed food has gotten an unfair stigma attached to it, and why it's actually such a critical step in growing our local food system. We're going to shine the light on some bottlenecks and challenges that a food processing enterprise might face, and who is innovating their way to growth and success.
We have to cook over 1,000 pounds of beans a week right now.
You know, specialty cheese is the fastest growing segment in the dairy industry.
Was there anyone making an artisan cracker in Vermont to go with all these wonderful Vermont artisan and farmstead cheeses? And I didn't see anyone doing it.
After a while, we realized, well, this is really taking a lot of my time and there's a business here. And, you know, Robin said, we need to spin this off into a company. And I said, I'll do it.
While I was growing vegetables, it's like, hey, we can't sell all of this. Some of it's number two products. Some of it's cosmetically challenged. Let's try and start doing something with all this produce. Let's add value to it.
There weren't really a lot of options for cider. And we started digging into some of the history that's out there. And this country was founded on cider.
We're here at Vermont Bean Crafters in the beautiful Mad River Valley in Warren, Vermont. Let's go process some food.
I worked on a half dozen different farms before starting Bean Crafters and was basically trying to figure out what I was going to do with my life. And
this is Joe.
I was growing an acre of black beans.
I've been a restaurant owner and a chef. I'm a trained chef.
This is also Joe.
Certain point, I started to burn out. You know, the restaurant industry is not very kind to the family life.
And this is the tale of two Joes and how they came to grow their own value-added food businesses.
The more layers of the food system I began seeing, and the more I realized there was this huge gap in that we actually needed conduits from the field to people's tables. You know, we needed, among other things, value-added products and post-harvest processing because people are more comfortable opening a can of beans than they are cooking from scratch.
As the state has seen a boom in farmers, young farmers coming back to the land, well, guess what? You know, you have more and more farmers all competing for a very tiny market.
More than anything, those farmers needed better customers, not more competition. I also realized that's where I wanted to put my time and energy.
We started going to the farmers market. The soup really took off. The next thing you know, I'm trying to rent space. I went and got a catering permit and a water permit for one of the local churches in Montpelier. They let me go in and use the kitchen on Monday and Tuesday. We kept making soup. Hunger Mountain Co-op took me on as a vendor. That was kind of really what started to drive the business. And then Mad River Food Hub opened up about 4 years ago.
Ah, the Mad River Food Hub, where Joe and Joe were once both anchor tenants. Let's check in on this magic food hub.
I'm Joshua Gibbs. I'm the general manager of the Mad River Food Hub, and we're here in Waitsfield, Vermont. Gonna take you on a little tour of the facility and show you what we do here.
Maybe you're wondering what a food hub is. A food hub aggregates, stores, processes, distributes, and/or markets locally produced foods. For folks trying to get into the local food biz, a food hub can make a world of difference.
Now all of a sudden you hit the Mad River Food Hub. You've got refrigeration, you've got the permits, the licenses, you can start to scale.
He would use the 40-gallon steam jacket and kettle.
You can expand, you can afford to buy some equipment.
He realized he couldn't produce enough here in one 40-gallon kettle, so he bought another one and we installed it for him. We supplied the power, upgraded the power in the room and so forth so he could do that. And it just left. It's been sitting right there for a good part of a year now, and we're kind of sorry to see it go, but it's a classic incubator problem. We nurture these companies until they're too large for us, and then we kick them out, and we have to go find new people to come in here and use this space.
It allows you to make that leap. I would not have been able to go from the church kitchen to a facility because I'm too small. I don't have the assets. I don't have collateral. The banks won't loan you money. You haven't been in business long enough.
The idea was that we'd create a processing center that farmers and food processors would come to and process their vegetables. We'd also create a storage place.
This is Robin Morris, who founded the Mad River Food Hub in 2011.
And it was really clear to me that the only way we could make the food hub work was to have a hybrid food hub that processed both meat and vegetables.
I'm Jacob Finson with Artisan Meats of Vermont. We're a small-scale meat value-added processor, and we work here out of the Mad River Food Hub. I can't say that I would have taken the leap to go out and acquire the funding. I mean, it would have been $250,000 capital outlay to do this on my own.
These processors start off, and they've got very little capital, and these machines are not cheap.
I did not have the knowledge or financial expertise to pursue that kind of funding. And frankly, I found it incredibly intimidating. For $150 a day though, and the cost of a little insurance, I can come in and use on demand.
Under USDA processing guidelines and regulations, the actual plant, the physical plant, is the responsible party. So as people are processing meat here under USDA inspection, they're actually quasi-employees of the Mad River Food Hub while they're here, and we're responsible for the management of the food safety.
Where is a possible point of contamination, and how can I control it or eliminate it so that when I'm done and it's packaged and it's labeled and I ship it to the grocery store, it's going to taste good, but it's not going to make anybody sick.
There is a huge code of federal regulations that you need to follow when it comes to processing food.
This is USDA inspection. You know, sanitation is a whole nother level.
You have to look at every process and everything, every step of the flow of food through this establishment.
It's that big shift from a restaurant mentality, or even some of the people coming in, and there's this huge thing around regulation and sanitation that it's very different. You're going into another profession, basically.
Producers are generally intimidated by inspection at first. Think, oh, there's this giant bureaucratic body that wants to govern everything I do. Really, the inspectors are here to help you make sure your customers are safe.
It takes a watchful eye to make sure that the producers themselves are doing the things correctly and documenting the right steps.
We have a great inspection team in Vermont. They're here to kind of like work with you to make sure that you're not gonna kill anybody.
The local food chain is very fragile, and we will break it very quickly if we start getting a lot of people sick.
There's this huge demand for processing facilities. And when it's gonna just keep increasing as this new federal regulation comes through, it's called the Food Safety Modernization Act, FSMA. You're gonna lose the home catering exemption. People are not gonna be able to process in their kitchens. And that's how a lot of these tiny businesses start. You know, you're just not gonna be able to do it. You're gonna have to have a facility like a food hub that's licensed, that's sanitary, that's regulated, you're gonna have to go in, rent time, and away you go.
Hooray for food hubs. They're a great way to get into the game. But what if you're not so sure you want to be the one who actually makes, packs, and ships your processed food? Enter co-packing, a clever and innovative food processing solution. At Bristol Bakery, Whitney Lamy shows us how co-packing is changing the game for food entrepreneurs and products. Like her very own Castleton crackers.
In the early 90s, I came across a homemade cracker recipe and would make it over the years for family and friends, and people would say, oh, you should sell these. I'd be like, yeah. But then I started paying attention to all the Vermont cheese companies popping up around the state. So I took baby steps, but those baby steps sort of exploded. My whole house was covered with crackers within a very short amount of time. You know, I just quickly outgrew my kitchen, and a friend of mine who was a business consultant sort of reined me in, because I was like, I gotta get a space. I need ovens. I can't keep doing all this by myself. And he said, wait a second. Do you want to be making crackers day in and day out? Or do you want to find a manufacturer to produce your crackers that you oversee, but then you can focus on sales and marketing and growing the company? And that really resonated with me. So that started my journey of working with co-packers around the state of Vermont.
Eventually, Whitney and her crackers found Kevin Harper and his bakers. With Kevin's manufacturing knowledge and a team of skilled workers, Whitney found a home where her crackers would be made for her so that she could focus on selling them.
You know, specialty manufacturing is where I would say you commit to a given segment or category of products, and you go deep in the range of services that you provide your prospective customers.
It's like sending a child to daycare. You know, it's sort of your baby, you have your vision, you know what you want from start to finish for your product, and it's getting that manufacturer to understand that and really buy into your concept and your vision.
If we're committed to this local movement and sustainable agriculture, then we need to be committed to sustainable value-add manufacturing.
Well, this all sounds great, but are there enough co-packers in Vermont to give locally processed food the boost it needs?
Vermont, especially in the food world, has such a strong brand. Yet, on the manufacturing side, there are challenges for sort of middle-level food producers in the state. There was a time period after being in Randolph that I actually had to take production out of the state, and it broke my heart because part of my story was I'm a Vermont product. But it's also, as a business owner and wanting to build and grow my brand, do I stop growth because it can't be made in Vermont? So I did have to make that decision.
Luckily for us, Kevin stepped in and brought the crackers home. But why aren't there more local co-packers processing more local food in Vermont?
This model comes with a certain amount of risk, and I'm frankly not sure I've figured out how to mitigate those risks. You can't take on too many because you'll dilute your service to those customers, but you can't take on too few because it only takes one to fade away and not be in business anymore, and it can be devastating.
So you can get a jump start in a local food hub. You can find a co-packer to split your workload, or you can take the bull by the horns and do it all yourself. Here are two of Vermont's favorites to tell us their stories of great success and what that means to their food community.
Jasper Hill Farm here is a typical hillside farm in the Northeast Kingdom. It's rocky, it's hilly, it's well suited for grazing cows.
With the possible exception of boiling maple sap down into syrup, there is no more beloved, quintessential Vermont processing pastime than turning milk into cheese. And no one does it better than the folks at Jasper Cellars in Greensboro. Their blue cheese was recently awarded best raw cheese in the world.
It has been an incredible, like, rush, kind of tail of the dragon experience.
No joke. But make no mistake, the brothers behind the Bailey Hazen Blue have a mission that is firmly rooted in the rocky hills of the Northeast Kingdom.
We're looking at developing economic mechanisms to take control of our price back and to create the circumstances where a dairy producer could opt out of global commodity markets.
Commodities? What is this, an econ class? Let me break it down. A commodity, like dairy, is a product where the price is set by the global marketplace. So if you want to get paid more for your commodity, you need to add value to it.
No, specialty cheese is the fastest growing segment in the dairy industry, and it can deliver just return that's many multiples of what commodity milk might be. It's a different kind of business. You know, it's a lot more complicated, and we learned that early on. You know, we came into this business a little starry-eyed, and it's amazing what's happened with American cheese in the last 10 years, and you know, we've been a part of that.
I doubt that the ancient Romans ever talked in terms of value-added product, but the gathering and pressing of cider does go back literal millennia. Cider's having itself a bit of a renaissance right now, and Vermonters are doing cider as well as anybody.
Our whole process has evolved dramatically. We started with like 40 grand with friends and family money and built a network of suppliers and built a market of, you know, interest.
And you know who's especially loving this revival? Apple growers. At Citizen Cider in Burlington South End, we learned why processing a popular product like hard cider leads to a crazy demand for local apple producers.
You know, we did a little over 5,000 gallons that first year, and that tanker truck holds over 6,000 gallons. You know, right now we're on like a once a week, it comes in with 6,000 gallons of fresh juice to ferment. We are buying whole fruit, we're not buying concentrate. We're probably the biggest buyer of whole fruit in Vermont. Our cider is a few dollars more, but it's because of how we're investing in the local ag system here in order to get this product to you. When we first came onto the scene, it was like the fruit that these guys were selling for processing cider apples, they were getting nothing for it. It was like a break-even kind of deal. We've been paying, you know, above market price for that fruit and trying to kind of raise that up as we've gone along.
And that's one way that this beautiful local food system can work. Once you get big enough, you can help others grow. Back to Mateo.
When Cabot called us and asked us to make for them a private label English style raw milk cheddar.
Cabot is the giant of Vermont's cheeseland, and they're a very helpful, friendly giant.
And the cheese was delicious. We knew we were onto something. And in 2006, Cabot Clothbound Cheddar won Best of Show at the American Cheese Society. So Clothbound has played a very important role. It gave us the weight we needed to build national distribution. So it's been a really important part of making all this happen, and just like to honor and acknowledge the role that, you know, a big company like Cabot has played in helping to juice, you know, the whole artisan cheese industry in Vermont.
Jasper Hill is now paying it forward by supporting other, smaller cheese producers who are just getting started.
You know, it's been 12 years since we started milking cows here, and it feels like we're just really getting going, getting to the work that we're really interested in doing, which is around community development and agricultural development. We have the infrastructure, we've built the markets, and we're in the process of building farms.
And one of the ways they make this happen is by being the core tenant.
At the Vermont Food Venture Center.
Right now we're in the section of the Food Venture Center, which is the anchor tenant, the sellers at Jasper Hill.
Jasper Hill and the Food Venture Center have created a dedicated space together where small cheese producers can come to grow their business with the helping hand of Jasper Hill. Let's get a little more detail on this.
They use this facility as the place where they're scaling up a cheese production line.
You know, cheese that's developed here at Jasper Hill Farm grow to 20 or 30 tons of production, moves to the Food Venture Center. We scale that up and then move that cheese and the cheesemaker and the equipment to a farm. So in essence, we're working on de-risking the startup of new farmstead cheese businesses.
Jasper Hill's helping hand goes beyond incubating other cheesemakers. Being a core tenant of the Vermont Food Venture Center is essential for the food hub's viability.
This, even though it's not to scale, is a good map of the Food Venture Center. One of the things in the designing of this building was the idea that, like a shopping mall, you would want anchor tenants who could pay the rent and who were established businesses that were going to be able to continue despite ups and downs in the economy. These two really allow us to provide these other services because they help, they're here 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, and they help pay the rent. They allow for our small incubator clients to see what it takes to get to the scale of a successful, you know, million plus dollar business. It's like having the high schoolers working with the, you know, the elementary schoolers. It really is terrific to have that graduated kind of business in one, all in one place.
By the way, the amazing woman we've been talking to is Sarah Waring, the executive director for the Food Venture Center, which is an important piece to the puzzle of processing food in Vermont and getting it to market.
From here across to about here, people don't really understand what happens. This is the part of the food system that is often invisible. This is where all of the food safety regulations come in. This is where all of the licensing and the liability and the insurance aspects come in. This is where significant contracts and deals with companies come in to be able to move and manage and handle all of that food stuff. One of the things I like to say is that farmers and chefs are pretty sexy, and that our mission is to make hair nets and hand sanitizer just as sexy as farmers and chefs.
Loads of small businesses like Vermont Kale Chips, Vermont Veggie Burger, and Switchel benefit from the Food Venture Center. And still, that's only part of what they do.
So in this kitchen, we are processing broccoli, and this broccoli has come from local farms. We've aggregated it here, and we're chopping it and making it into basically almost the exact same kind of product that a college or a hospital or a school would be using from Jolly Green Giant or from Reinhardt or whoever. But the idea is that this is local, so they are often willing to pay more. It's also creating jobs here in Vermont. And again, this is where that piece on the mural is so important to us, because there are jobs in the food system which are not farming and are not chefs, but are somewhere in the middle, right? And it allows us to try to create a market pathway for farmers that would increase their viability on the landscape. And ultimately, if we lose our landscapes, our working landscapes, then this entire food system idea is not going to be feasible, right? So we're trying to create a higher value, and we're also trying to create a larger market for their local product by doing the processing here.
But why is it so important for us to do the processing here? Well, when you look at the
infrastructure of the global economy, and we look at things like pollution and, you know, water quality and soils and our limited natural resources, if we don't make better use of what we have here, we will be at the whim of those trends that are happening globally. And if we do make better use of it, we will be resilient through those changes. And I think that for us is really critical. If we don't have jobs, we don't have a sustainable community. If we don't have farms, we don't have a sustainable food source. And if we don't have connections to our distributors or our schools or our hospitals, we're never going to be able to keep a consistent market going. We're fighting against this food system that is cheap and easy and fast, and it's enormous. It's enormous. What we're doing here is a very small thing, but it's so important when we think about the future.
Right.
It's kind of incredible. Gives me the shivers when I think about it.
How do we get more raw, local ingredients into those convenient foods that the public really wants? Honestly, we've got a long way to go. But a handful of smart, savvy, local entrepreneurs are showing us how it's done.
The goal has really been to use cheese to transform our community by just creating a different kind of economic reality here. Last year in our business, there were 8 real estate transactions, and there are babies popping out all over the place, and it's working. We're bucking the trend up here.
So we're still cooking. You know, it's not a factory. We're a semi-factory, almost factory, but you know, it's still pretty personal.
We just sent off 750 black bean burgers and like 1,000 falafel. And I don't even know what schools they're going to anymore. They're just they aren't gone, and it's really cool. I don't know, and there's so much work left to be done.
That's probably been the biggest thrill, is just, you know, being there and showing my kids you can do whatever you want, really, if you have the heart and the passion.
We've talked to a lot of people this episode, and one thing we've learned, there are a bunch of great businesses just waiting to be launched, putting local ingredients into convenient, comforting, and familiar meals that we'll all enjoy. We'll see you next time.
Make sure to come back for the next episode of The Local Motive, when we move into the exciting world of distribution. Distribution, distribution, distribution.
Well, there isn't any distributor out there who's like, I got it easy.
Cisco Corporate has about 425,000 customers, about 45,000 associates, and we're a $500 billion a year company.
Sometimes it can be easier to get a head of lettuce from California than from the person down the road.
And I thought, you know what, I have to get my tomatoes on their trucks.
And let's take a look at how the local food system in Vermont can overcome the challenges and bottlenecks it faces to efficiently and effectively distribute the love.
Let's go move some food.
Production of The Local Motive is supported in part by Ben & Jerry's, City Market, Gardner's Supply Company, Hanover Co-op Food Stores, Hickok & Boardman Insurance Group, Price Chopper, UVM Dining, the Vermont Community Foundation, Vermont Farm to Plate Network, VSECU, and by viewers like you.